I think Italy had their approach.
Oh, colla.
Honestly, this is my opinion from the rest.
Oh, colla.
The idea of beauty is the first thing, and the idea of the quality. And so sometimes, yes, the function.
Function. Oh, Asplund.
Yeah, but also he was doing a lounge that, let's say, the ergonomy is not probably the best one, but looks amazing. So I think it's two different ideas, of course.
I think when you sit down in an Italian manufacturer, it takes four sentences and they start talking about like estetica, la linea.
Yeah.
Which in Sweden it's rather like, well, how are
yeah.
How
are.
Yeah, it's more rational. But I think also that what I like about Lucas things is that they are like a cross between these things. And we are old friends, I mean, personal friends. And back in the days when you moved to Sweden the first time, I used to bring you along to see Swedish design.
Yeah,
and I took him, showed him books and so on. Because I think
I'm
it's...
It's
really, really interesting how you cross-pollinate, because that's what you've been talking about. The Benigni glass. Yeah, it's an amazing thing.
The
shit.
Oh, that där rötiga, ja.
In the role of Swedish Italian history is a woman who had her fantastic magazine on Strandberg and Sjö. So I might talk about Esther. Yeah. And how she did something already in the 30s.
Yes.
What was that?
She did an amazing exhibition. Venetian glass,
yeah.
Murano glass.
Murano glass, yeah.
And she went to Murano and she did a tour. things from chandelier to
No, for quality.
She took advantage of this.
Because probably that time there was no email or stuff like that, that you can contact people so easily. So I think it was very interesting the way to create also this combo.
Då ringer.
So you know, in
this
a way,
is actually a picture from
the inte IKEA i alla fall. Kännes på kvaliteten, den är för tung.
The Milano Fiera every year now, but how important have the exhibitions been historically? I'm thinking of the Triennale.
Honestly, not because I'm Italian, but I truly think that is the most important week. I don't want to call fair, it's a week, a creative week.
For people from all over the world.
Yeah, but from all the different, from fashion to car to lifestyle to design, all the creative industry somehow is there for a week, and it's huge. It's like 500,000 people come to Milan.
That's fantastic. The whole city is moving.
And the city also is, you know, if you ask to someone in the city, taxi driver, they know what is going on, so they are part of that. It's amazing.
What would you say is the golden age of Italian design?
My age? No. I think it was kind of long time, from 50s until 80s was a very 30 years of amazing exploration. Then later, of course, there was in the beginning of 90s Giulio Cappellini that opened the door to foreign designer that created another era, but I think for Italian design, the one they made in Italy that everyone knows was from 50s to 80s.
And then you jumped over the 80s.
Yeah.
Was that on purpose? Because in the 80s, the Memphis era was really strong.
Ugh.
We have some light in
Yeah, but now for us, it's very strong. But during the 80s, nobody Memphis almost in Italy, or at least was so radical, that movement that was not successful.
That was anti-design. design project.
It was the idea of to do something if cheap. That was the idea, something affordable. But the result was something that was absolutely not affordable.
And who bought it?
Collector.
Yeah, museums.
I was out. Yeah, for example. So in a way, some idea that proposed to do something affordable came out with something absolutely exclusive. That is also the beauty on creating something. You never know where you land it.
Yeah. And Eero, what would you say is the
Eero?
Swedish designer. That's what I'm asking for. Personligen väldigt förtjust
i 50- och 60-tal.
50-60-tal. Och sen så tycker jag att de design gick lite vilse där, som jag nämnde förut. Ergonomin och så här. Och det blev lite tråkigt. Och självklart så tycker jag att det är fantastiskt just nu. Och jag tycker att det är som några få företag gjorde i början på 90-talet. Gjorde mycket för svensk design. Och idag tycker jag att det finns en självsäkerhet i svensk design som inte fanns förut.
Och detta att man idag, som, alltså er designstudio eller arkitektstudio, ni har ju en lista över, är det 40, 50, 60 olika samarbetspartner jobbar med.
Åh gud!
Ja, är det framtiden att man har väldigt många olika sådana?
Men ska vi ju satsa på Loftus i många år?
Nej,
jag var ju inte på Trahäntan, där borde du spranga för att titta om de hade
någon brick.
Något nytt företag som man inte har jobbat med, eller någon som jobbar i ett företag som sen...
Jag har tagit det där då, så stickar vi lite tidigare om jag kan.
Det är ett företag som har jobbat i 10 år nu. Men jag har utställt under senaste Milanomässan om bara det här 10-åriga samarbetet. Det är ett av de klassiska italienska möbelföretag. Ett litet familjeföretag vi älskar på studion. Och ja, det drivs av två bröder och en syster. Och pappan är fortfarande kvar och går runt och i fabriken fast den är gammal. Och det är, jag skulle vilja säga att idag är det samarbetet mycket mer som en familjerelation än ett designsamarbete. Det är faktiskt ganska fantastiskt.
Do you also have family relations with the producers of yours? Like him, for example?
Yeah, but I think... I think in Sweden it's more difficult to find a company that is run by family than it's different, completely different approach. Of course, it's in the end,
yes.
With also other company that I'm working here, I have a very good relation, but the approach on doing things is very different.
What's the largest difference?
The speed in doing things, and that especially here is much more planning and knowing what also the market needs. In Italy, it's more, especially when it's a company run from a family, if they like, they do.
Talking about speed. The program is over. Thank you. Eero Koivisto, Luca Niketto.
Thank you
very much for coming. Tack för att ni var här. Tack för att ni där hemma har tittat också. Titta gärna nästa vecka, då ska vi prata om vardagsbonusar. De där sakerna som ingen riktigt tänker på, men som är så viktiga. Ses då.
Så väntar annat. Naturfilmaren Gordon har fått uppdraget att följa svartbjörnar i Minnesota under 3 säsonger. Och det är alldeles strax vår under Gordons första möte med björnfamiljen.
Sin tid. Teknologiska riktmärken. Hemligheten bakom de här fantastiska byggnadsverken. Världens broar, fredagar i Kunskapskanalen.
Tokyo är till ytan lika stort som Korsika och där bor ändå nära 40 miljoner japaner. Utan stor konkurrens är Tokyo världens folkrikaste stad. Och hur ser en sån metropol ut uppifrån? Se City på taken om 50 minuter. Fram till dess ska vi möta våren i Minnesota tillsammans med svartbjörnar och en björnrädd naturfilmare.
The American Black Bear. The bear that attacks more people than any other. To some, they're unpredictable and dangerous.
When it turned, the bear's head was right there.
In the water?
In the water. By the back of the neck.
Other people think you've got them completely wrong. I'm Gordon Buchanan, and I'm a wildlife cameraman. I want to find out the truth about black bears. In this series, I'm going to try and film a bear family over three seasons. From the moment they wake up in the spring, to the time they hibernate in autumn. This is the only place in the world I can do it. But to tell you the truth, I'm a little bit scared.
Just been bitten for the first time by a bear.
Northern Minnesota is just west of the Great Lakes, near the border with Canada. It's one of the last great wilderness areas in the US. This is bear country. The little town of Ely lies at its heart. Thousands of people begin trips into the backwoods from here. Bears are the one animal people do not want to meet in the forest. I'm going to try and shoot them with a camera, not with a gun. Bears have a big reputation, and they've become monsters in our imagination.
Until the moment I see one in the wild, I'll know how I truly feel about it, but it is an animal that I have a healthy respect for and fear of. When you look into a bear's eyes, I think they've got a mad look about them, I think.
My biggest problem will be just seeing one. Black bears live in thick forests and are almost impossible to find. However, in the woods just outside Ely, I have a unique opportunity to get close to them. That's because of one remarkable man. He could help us reveal a side of bears that no one has seen before.
Hello.
Are you Gordon?
I am.
Hey, congratulations.
How are you doing?
Good, come on.
Glad to be here.
Yeah, glad here.
I probably know more about you than you know about me.
Dr. Lynn Rogers has been a bear biologist for 44 years.
Here, get in that side.
I was forgetting what country I was in.
Yeah, you're in America now.
If anyone can get me close to bears, it's Lynn.
So in a normal year, they'd all still be in hibernation.
Yeah, right, yeah. Oh no, the earliest ones would be coming out.
25 kilometers out of town is a cabin where I'll be staying. Lynn wants to show me that there are bears living right on my doorstep.
In your professional opinion, where's the closest bear to us right now?
There's probably one bear for each 1.5 square miles. So, I don't know, it could be anywhere.
Oh, wow. That is definitely a bear here.
Yeah.
So this is, come on, he's warmed up here and just scratched his back on this rough
bottom. Yeah, but it's not for comfort, it's to communicate. Every bear that comes by will smell the bear on here and stop and sniff it.
It's actually quite soft.
Yeah, it's actually really pleasant to pet a bear.
Mm-hmm. I'll take your word for it. Mm. That bear?
Oh, there you go. Where you go? Those are teeth marks. Probably a male bear.
So when the male bear stands up, he's taller than you.
Yes. Right. Yep. Okay, here's one where probably a bear.
I just didn't realize that they were that big. When I think of a grizzly bear, I know that they are enormous, and I know that polar bears are enormous. Black bears always think of being little bears. These marks aren't left by a little bear. You're talking something significantly taller than me. No matter how big our brains are, when you're out here in the forest, it's how big your teeth are, how strong you are, and compared to a black bear, we are nothing.
Ska du ögonpåsa dig? Ska du ögonpåsa dig?
Jag lägger över de kakorna som är kvar på ett litet fat, så kan du ta dem imorgon.
Ja, oh. Alltså.
Is found nowhere else in America. There are plenty of bears here, but they're hidden in the trees. Fortunately, Lynn's managed to put radio calls on 10 wild bears, which will help with the search. Before I begin filming, there are a few basic steps I need to take. I want to get a feel of the lie of the land and how difficult it's going to be to track them.
Right, guys.
I'm here with the rest of the crew.
Okay, see you later.
But for this first attempt to find a bear, it's important I go alone. That way, I don't make any noise. I've radio tracked animals before. What I don't know is what a bear will do when it